587 of those guys. That's a lot. Did you ever stop to think about how many notes there are in the right-hand part alone to the D-minor Prelude from Volume 1 of the Well-Tempered Clavier? Well, I counted them, and there are 587. What do you think of that, Wanda? How do we pick out a few essential notes from all these 587? Well, that's what we're going to do in this video. I hope you'll join me for some counting of lentils and listening to some essential notes to give foreground and background to this D minor prelude by Bach. Well, hi there. It's me, Penny. Welcome back to my practice room. You know, as I've been teaching and adjudicating over the years, one of the things that I notice is notiness. Playing can sound a bit like a machine, or as my teacher Constance Keene used to say, like a sewing machine, a little motor going around and around, with not a whole lot of attention paid to pulling out some of the notes and putting them into the foreground and having others in the background. Doing this at the piano requires use of your eyes, but mostly your ears. I have today the D minor prelude from the Prelude and Fugue, number 6 from Volume 1 of the Well-Tempered Clavier by J.S. Bach. And this is a popular piece. Just to give you a recap, it's the one that goes like this. And it continues in that fashion for the whole 2 pages. That right-hand part alone, which has these triplets. Do you know how many notes are in that right-hand part? There's 587 notes. The left hand has maybe a third as many notes. The right hand has the challenge of not sounding notey and mechanical and robotic. But how on earth do we pick out which notes we want to put into the foreground? Now, as a comparison, in this pretty little dish that was my grandparents, I counted out, you're welcome, 587 lentils. This is how many notes there are in that right-hand part. 587 of those guys. That's a lot. How do we pick which of these lentils we want to sparkle a little bit more? Part of it comes down to experience and also knowing that there is no right or wrong way to do this. What you love to listen to, what makes you excited, those are the notes you bring out. That's what you listen for. So in this video, I am showing how we went from this many notes in the right hand to bringing out this many in the foreground and having the rest of them in the, shall we say, Bach ground. Oh, that's a bad pun. But we want to get it to sound like it has some dimension, some texture. As a good example, I'm going to put on the screen a very lovely still life painting to show an example of a painting with something in the foreground and something in the background. Of course, the flowers are front and center. That's what you see. That's in the foreground. In the background, we have this little nature scene. And that invites the eye to create the illusion of depth, even though it's just a flat canvas. And so we're trying to do that in sound. So many people listen with their eyes. And I find a lot of videos on YouTube where there are strobing neon lights in time with the music. And while that is very interesting to look at, I think it is rather harmful to the act of listening. I came across a quote from Arthur Rubinstein recently about how the best way to listen and to appreciate and enjoy good music, difficult music, is to listen with your eyes closed. Pure, active, quality listening is truly about the sound. I'm going to play you the 212 that I extracted as my essential notes. The left hand, I've basically left it intact, you know, reduced a couple of the repeated notes. Okay, so now I'm going to put up on the screen a copy of the original sheet music. And you'll see that I've put a little red double stem over the notes that I have chosen as essential and in the foreground of this picture. And I'm going to play the right-hand part maybe even sing some of these notes as we go. So just the right hand here, I'm going to take nice and slowly. Arrival there in F major, that's at the downbeat of measure 6. Carrying on, C, A, things start to get a little spicy here. Find that with those red stems. Movement by step over the long term. Measure 9. C. Triplets here. B flat, D, G, B flat. Measure 16, B flat, G, A, C sharp, B flat, G, A, C sharp, D, E flat, D, C, D, E flat, D, C. Step from the C sharp, B flat, A, G, C sharp, C sharp, B flat, A, G, A, G, B sharp, G, F natural. Ooh, I love that one. A, G, B flat. lyricism, these accidentals. It's good stuff. C sharp, E, G, D, A, D, F, G sharp. Now here, middle of 24 through most of 25, we get these descending triplets, and the first of each note is a descending chromatic scale to listen for, starting with the B natural, B flat, A, G sharp, G natural, F sharp, A, F natural, E natural, E flat, D, and then we got our cadence, C sharp, D. So, whew, I'm out of breath now. That's what I'm listening for. Those notes I sang, 212 of them should be, unless I might have missed one because the left hand grabs one later on. But 212 notes whittled down from 587 is pretty good. And so if you can hear that by going deep into the key on those notes and singing and listening for them, you'll be in good shape. And then when you go to pick it up, and as I say, I have not yet learned this piece completely. I will get a performance of it up hopefully in the near future, but by listening for those notes, when I play it up to speed, I'm still hearing those notes that I sang. And I think that's a piece like this needs that. And of course, the fugue is a whole other story. It is not not nearly as notey. And so I think that if we do this kind of practice for the prelude, then it will aid in our performance of the fugue, for we'll be able to convey a different character of sound more easily, because we will have come hot off the torch, the flaming torch of the prelude. I want to show you now on the screen my reduction using the Muse score of just those right hand notes. So you don't see any triplets anymore. But it's still in 4/4. So you could even play it like this. So the right hand, these are the notes that you just saw with the red stems on them, the notes I was singing. Screen the version of both hands. Thank you. And on that note, I'm going to wrap up this video on listening for foreground in the music of J.S. Bach, Mr. B, as I like to call him. And you know, it's lunchtime. And these 587 lentils here, they're calling to me. So I'm going to cook those for lunch. Anyhow, I hope that this was helpful and give you some ideas and perhaps a bit of a creative approach to your practicing. I'll be back again soon for some more performances, teaching tips, practice ideas, and so forth. And thanks again for watching. Happy practicing. Bye-bye.
I dropped one.